potential for abuse is enormous because of the way the thing is set up.
Agencies are funded by how many children they have in care. And if the number of children decrease, they get less funding.
We are making money.
They get all this money from the government from donations, and they're using it to protect themselves, not the children.
Almost every single child was on a neuroleptic.
A very clear example of empire building.
Thunder Bay is benefiting big time with our kids in care. I don't know how many mortgages they're paying.
This baby snatching system became a big business only in the last couple of decades.
Big business. Is that what child protection should be about? Big business? Those are scenes from the documentary More Powerful Than God, questioning the power of Ontario's Children's Aid Society. Look, we've all been shocked by the most recent scandal at the CAS, giving a little two-year-old girl to her stepdad, Makbul Hassan, a man with a criminal record who began sexually and physically abusing her from the time she was 7 until she got the hell out of there, ran away at 15, and reported the abuse to police. Where's the accountability here? For not only the responsibility of where they place kids in the first place, but for, well, the accountability for making some rather questionable decisions to rip families apart. The oversight is pitiful. For years now, Ontario Ombudsman Andre Morin has been asking the government for the power to investigate the Children's Aid Society. 5 bills presented and rejected since 2006. I mean, well, what is the holdup? For more, we go to Queen's Park columnist Christina Blizzard. Christina, just before we get into the angle of the ombudsman, and this is something you've been pushing for in your column, give Mr. Morin, the ombudsman, the right to investigate this particular group like he is able to most other agencies. Before we do that, I need to follow the money trail because I think it's incredibly important here. It's not just somewhat relevant, it's incredibly important. Talk to me a little bit about families who are looking to adopt, but they can't do it because it's in the incentive, financial incentive of the CAS to not allow them to adopt.
Well, absolutely, Charles. As soon as I wrote this story, my email flooded and the phone calls started to come in from loving families who had been foster parents and who wanted to adopt those children. And they were put through hoops by the Children's Aid Society, and many of them said that they felt that it was all about the money, that if they adopted that child or those children, in some cases there were 2 children they wanted to take into, they'd been living with them, these children had been living with them, they'd become parts of these loving families, and the families wanted to adopt because they had become so attached to them, and they were put through hoops by the Children's Aid Society. Some of them estimated they spent hundreds of thousands of dollars in legal fees trying to adopt these children, but they couldn't because the Children's Aid Society put up so many barriers and blocks to this. So how is that in the best interest of the child when you're looking to put them into a stable home and they won't do it?
You know, it's just crazy because if you're fostering a child, you're getting money. You've got a financial incentive to keep on being a foster parent. But if you want to become an adoptive parent, you're not going to get that money. On the other hand, and this is the hand that's most important in this one, on the other hand, the Children's Aid Society, as long as that child is a foster child, there's money coming to the Children's Aid Society. But once that child is no longer a foster child, ain't no money.
Absolutely, and that's what these families feared, and more as I saw all these emails, all these phone calls, that was what I started to suspect was the issue here, that if they lost those, if those foster children were adopted, then the Children's Aid Society would lose that funding.
200,000 children, Christina, Children's Aid Society, I mean, that's a huge business. Let me ask you this, how difficult is it for you as a columnist, a reporter, a journalist, how difficult is it for you to do a serious interview with anybody at the Children's Aid Society on any case at all?
You can't do it. That's the issue. It's this sort of institutionalized protectionism for the industry because they will not speak to you about any one case citing privacy issues, which is precisely why we need Andre Morin, the ombudsman, because he can get behind those issues. He can talk to them. He can investigate cases and then report generally on them. We don't need the names, the details, the kind of things we found out in that recent court case, that horrific court case that documented this terrible abuse of a young woman. But if Andre Morin had the ability to investigate systematically what's going on within the Children's Aid Society, he could then report on these individual cases, without actually naming names, but we would have his, we would know that we would have the integrity of his office behind that.
All right, now in this documentary, which we're encouraging everybody to watch, they say that it's only the last couple of decades where this thing has really metastasized and it's become a big business. What's different about the last two decades? What's the variable we're looking for here? What changed?
Well, I'm not sure what changed. I just know that there are now systemic problems. I mean, you know, when it's gone from perhaps a case by case, when you're funding Children's Aid Societies on a case-by-case basis, clearly it is in the best interest of the industry, the child welfare industry, to keep as many children within that industry as possible. And that is never in the best interest of a child. It's never in the best interest of a child to be kept in a fragile sort of relationship. They are much better if families want to adopt. They are going to be in a stable, loving family, and that is much better for them.
The exposure here is incredible. Parents, no warrants necessary. Somebody not liking you, dropping the dime on you, making all kinds of claims. They can take your child or your grandchild away willy-nilly. It is like Stalinism. And on the other hand, if you want to go after them, if you want to hire a lawyer and sue them, forget about it, because it's impossible to prove that what they did was in bad faith.
Well, of course, and there's always this, there's always this question that hovers over you anytime there's been the Children's Aid have been called. Imagine the kind of question that brings in about your family. Do you really want to make public allegations that the Children's Aid, just by simply saying that the Children's Aid sent someone over to investigate, is very difficult for you. It's very difficult for you to deal with that. You certainly don't want your neighbors, friends, and family knowing that the Children's Aid came in, and yet the Children's Aid Society is able to do this. We've all heard horror stories of legitimate, loving families, such as the one, there was a case in Aylmer, Ontario. I believe that it was a religious family who, as you reported, they did not believe that, they believed in the biblical edict of, sparing the rod, spoiling the child, so to speak. And they had the children taken from them. There were horrific photographs of those children clinging to their parents, not wanting to be parting from them. Well, you know what? If they were abusive parents, the children would not have been clinging to them. They would have been running towards the Children's Aid workers. Clearly something is very wrong with a system when, on the other hand, we had this horrific case that we talked about, where a two-year-old little girl with no biological connection to a single man with a criminal record was put into his care, and she spent years being abused by that man until she was able to escape.
Christina, thank you for writing up a storm in your columns and for being on with us and for doing what you're doing for the parents of Ontario. Thank you so much.
Thanks for following up, Charles.
The parents and their children. And once again, we encourage to do whatever it takes to get Andre Moran, the ombudsman, on this file. We need new legislation. Be a citizen of Adler Nation. Send us email, charlesadler@sunmedia.ca. We read them all because you matter and your words matter to us.